Cool. So while the video system is set up, that's okay?
Yeah, we're good
Great.
to go.
Okay, thanks. Well, first of all, thanks a lot for having me tonight. It's really nice because I recently moved to London with the weather, you know, and it's really nice to see a bit of non-clouds. And thanks a lot for it's the first time I speak to an event in Amsterdam, like big crowd. So as Hilke said, I'll be talking a bit about deep learning stuff. It's not specifically about in our software. I happen to work for a software company that makes it a bit easier to develop that kind of stuff, but mostly the standard stack. So just so I know a bit what kind of technical levels, what you know. Just if you call yourself a data scientist, could you raise your hand? Yeah. Okay, cool. Does any of you have already worked with deep learning frameworks, TensorFlow? Okay. Wow, that's great. That's a lot. So I would say I'm a beginner in this field as well. I mean, I'm learning every day, so I hope this serves as an introduction, and there's definitely people who are more involved in this space and have been doing research. So this is more applied research. As Hilke presented, this all comes from a frustration that one of my colleagues had about us making jokes in French, and instead of, you know, paying Google Translate, we decided to build our own system because we were a tech company. So yeah, anyway. So quick words about myself. I've been in a few fields, graduating in a few masters, starting in economics, went to innovation management, and really fell in love with data science 3 years ago. Many things interest me. Deep learning is one of them. I started, I think, a year ago playing a bit with TensorFlow, which is becoming slowly a stable stack, I guess. And yeah, I'm traveling a lot. Third time in Amsterdam, so quite excited. Hope to visit a bit over the weekend. Anyway, let's go back to the topic. A bit of project motivation. Trying to have a high-level view of what does machine translation mean and where it comes from. It's like data science, it's not new. There's been a bit of research, so I'll try to lay a bit of background about it. Technical foundations for the translation system that we've built, mostly thanks to the TensorFlow stack. Talking a bit about attention and the transformer models. So just ha have, I does that sound familiar to any of you? Yeah, okay. Well, quite a big show of hands still. A bit smaller, but yeah, that's great. So I hope you learn a few stuff, or like, don't hesitate to ask questions. Bring some precisions if you want, if you really know this kind of framework. By the end, I'll run a quick, a live demo. Obviously, I prepared some translation which work well. And I'll try to walk you also through the code and the way we've implemented it into our software. So yeah, be ready for some code in the presentation and some demo. Normally, I check the internet is all right, so no demo effect tonight. Okay, so we already touched a bit upon that. I think translation, when you are working in a team with multiple nationalities, is really, really important. We are scaling every year. We are doubling the size of the team, and that provides quite a challenge. We should be opening maybe an office in Asia at some point. That will bring new challenges. We have probably at least more than 10 nationalities represented, and it's a problem for a company like us, which is still fairly small. We hope to make it bigger, but for one of our clients, for instance, and this is the case probably at companies you work for, it's an extremely critical component of for instance, marketing. So we work with Unilever. They have tons of brands that you all know. Either you drink it, you eat it, or you wash with it. And they're being used throughout the world. They're really interested. They have a great marketing. That's really what they do. And that's for every country in the world, or almost. They do quite a bit of social listening, and one of the motivations behind it, and this is, it was generally speaking for when you listen media, when you listen to social media, you want to get to a common reference language in order to conduct some analysis. So this is one of the ways to do it. So obviously, the initial reaction was like, why don't you use Google Translate? It works really well. And actually, it's made by the same people who make the most popular deep learning software anyway. And I would have to, I have to say that at least for popular languages, it works really, really, really well. I mean, they have a lot of training data, they have a lot of researchers on types of architecture to solve that kind of problem. But the problem is that... Actually, next slide, yeah. Sorry. Yeah, the problem is it's quite expensive. So it's actually more interesting to... yeah, okay, I had the figure there. The current pricing is around $20 for a 1 million number of characters. So I tried to look up the number of characters in Lord of the Rings to make a an estimation. I couldn't find it easily, so I had an estimation with a Bible. But for the Bible, it would cost you $70. The Bible is like common reference, no religion specific. It's just a standard to have an overview. Which I mean, if you're thinking about the scale of a giant corporation which would like to listen to millions of feeds of social media every hour, could be a bit costly. Thankfully, TensorFlow is there. I mean, you could do it in Café. No, I don't want to enter a battle of which deep learning framework is best. But there happens to be a Google research. We made a specific package for this type of task on top of TensorFlow, which is quite easy to use. Surprisingly easy to use. Cool. So, a little background about machine translation, generally speaking, not just the latest work of Google, and why it's so challenging. Generally speaking, we are talking about something that is hard, even for humans. If you compare the scale of difficulty of different problems, recognizing images is pretty easy. We all learn to do it by a three-year-old. We don't learn to translate a language until we are, it depends, but generally speaking, maybe 10, 15 years or even older. So that explains also why for machines, it's really hard. It also depends a lot on the languages, obviously, because that's also what's great about humanity is we invented so many different ways to communicate. Sometimes it's the same concept, sometimes it's different concepts. With different grammars, so that's what I mean by syntactic. Syntactic parsing is about parsing a language through, let's say, an objective grammar. Some languages have a concept of genders. Most have a concept of adjectives. But there can be a lot of combinations around the different grammar types. It's really something that's hierarchical by nature, which is, from the way computers were designed, not so natural. So making a matrix-like computer-like to run matrix operations. They were at least designed to do that, and making a hierarchy work in this is a technical means a few technical challenges. Just an example of something that is super hard for computers to do, which is coreference resolution. So a typical line of joke about why did the chicken cross the street? Here it's just an animal. That's something that we do easily. The joke is pretty simple and works in every language. For a computer, understanding that the animal didn't cross the street because it was too tired is actually hard. What does it mean? So that's just an example, but if you want to understand concepts that are natural to us, like sarcasm, idioms, or even just introduce a new word or a new concept to an existing language, computers are really not great, I mean, at least naturally, to do that sort of thing. So here, in this example, and I will use it across the presentation, we'll see that actually now we have models that enable computers to understand this kind of coreference, to understand the relationship between different words in a sentence based on a kind of coreference or a meaning. A few notes on history. And I hope, Tom, I don't say anything wrong. Don't hesitate to precise. I did not read the entire. There's hundreds and hundreds of academic papers around it, so I've tried to do a high-level summary. It started quite a long time ago. The different approaches around translation, and there was something by IBM that was more focusing on different rules and really hard coding specific things about the grammar of a specific language and mapping it to another language. But still, it was quite of a breakthrough that you could do that. And for a very, very long time, for a few decades, there were some improvements, I would dare to say, rather in an incremental way, about improving these rules. So in 1996, there was Babelfish, which was the first online version of such a tool that people could use. Google Translate was only released 10 years later. And I mean, we probably all remember it. It sucked, right? I think it took quite a while. 1 year ago, they updated it to with deep learning in the backend, and now it kind of makes sense. Having said that, I don't know, like, has anyone, like, for I don't know, legal contract or anything, trusted Google Translate? No. Oh, okay. Interesting. Okay. Yeah. So it's not completely there yet. Hopefully, at least that's my hope. It's likely to change in the coming years because there are just some. When you look at the pace of advancement, and I'll walk you through a few graphs that show it. Machines could become better than humans at this task. So the type of architecture of neural networks that I'll be talking about is the transformer, and that was released last year. The first scientific paper on using deep learning for machine translation was in 2014. So it's pretty recent. It's been 4 years since researchers have started to apply this set of technique to this task. Um, A few comments on the background of the first kind of approach, which is statistical machine translation. The limitation it had essentially was that it would really not generalize well. So you'd get a corpus, for instance, if you wanted to translate a book that worked well for the context of the book, and if you applied it to something else, then it would be entirely lost. And the problem that I explained earlier about finding coreference, those would not be taken into account. Those were really rules that would kind of work, but it hadn't any sense of a meaning or of relationship between words. And also, it would require a lot of post-processing, which means that if you want to run it at a large scale, not great, because you need a human expert to always monitor it. That part, I think I'll skip. I'll not touch too much if you already know it, but just an intro about deep learning. Very quickly, it's a type of architecture type of algorithm which relies on little neurons, which are computation units, which apply an activation function. You design a network of those different computing units, and those can be used as algorithms to answer various tasks. Most of the work, actually, in the research is around finding the right architecture, so how you define the graph that connects these little neurons together to answer whether it's driving a car, translating something, or recognizing an image. One of the elements that is used, for instance, for an activation layer is the rectifier linear unit, which is this graph. And surprisingly, that framework, which was theorized 30, 40 years ago, suddenly for complex tasks such as machine translation, suddenly became to perform extremely well, mostly because now we have the computing resources to make these little things work. They are optimized through actually standard stuff, which are slightly optimized, like gradient descent, backpropagations, and a lot of very smart people are finding ways to optimize it in a better way. One graph that I think is very interesting, looking at the history of the performance of neural machine translation, depending on the architecture. I'll talk a bit more about architecture. So we are using here, for translation, there is a metric that is the standard used in academia called the Blue Score, which is counting. The idea is you count the, you have examples of language A and the translation in language B, and you compare the result of a model to the ground truth of a translation across different n-grams. So n-grams are a sequence of words of a given length. So 2 gram is I am, etc. So here you had the brown and the purple, which were machine translation, but not using, we're using rules, and there neural machine translation. And you can see that suddenly, in just 1 year, you got a significant improvement in performance. That was really breaking the linear rule of the other models. And so that's in 2016. So we'll see in last year if the trend continued. A different note of background, I'm going a bit fast. One of the things that is making neural translation work is the fact that deep learning, and that's the magic of matrix factorization, is able to, for each word, to derive a corresponding word vector. So it's useful. It's actually not just useful. It's actually a requirement because algorithms work with numbers. So you need to have a good representation of what is a word for a computer. Those results are quite famous now. It's the paper I think was published 2 years ago, and like there's still a lot of people who blog about it because it defines a geometry and even a kind of algebra for language. So, for instance, if I remember the example correctly, if you translate every word, so a king, into its word vector, and if you you take the vector of king minus the vector of man, I think you get the something that is close to the vector of queen. And you have interesting properties like the vector of Paris to France and London to the UK are parallel. So it understands like a relationship between city, country and capital, etc., etc. So it's really cool because you make a lot of visualizations that are interesting, and it means that it was the first time you could get something that naturally would make sense on a mathematical sense and on the linguistic sense, which used to be like communities that were a bit different, but now you could bridge the gap. And that really is at the heart of neural machine translation, because having this space for words enables you to, well, it's an embedding, and based on the embedding, you can do really cool things. A few approaches were tried to make, because when you think about it, going back to the word vectors, the word vector is really, you don't require deep learning. The paper chose to use deep learning as a framework, but it was actually a simple matrix factorization because it had only one layer. So that's not new. That's actually a good idea, but that was not new. But then if you want to apply it for so sequence translation, the initial approach naturally is using recurrent neural network, because language is a sequential thing by nature, or at least in the sequential nature is very obvious in Indo-European languages, maybe a bit different in other languages. So that was the approach that researchers tried first. However, had a few problems. First with memory, performance is important, but computation is important too, the complexity of algorithm, etc. And that's something that's especially true for deep learning. They're hard to converge. I guess a few of you in the audience have had the problem with, like, you didn't choose the right learning rate, so you spent dozens of euros on GPU and for nothing because your network just completely diverges and gives you nothing. That's especially true for RNN, and it's really, really slow. Yeah, if you're running on a cloud GPU, you have to pay every hour, so you want to optimize for that. Maybe I want to buy, like now that I've wasted so much money in that, I want to buy myself a server with GPU in my house. I need some Christmas money. Anyway, data scientist problems. An architecture that for RNN that is popular is long short-term memory. That was one of the approaches that were tried. It's interesting because it can create this relationship between sequential words, so kind of answering the question of coreference resolutions. But it has the same shortage than, generally speaking, RNNs. It's really not very efficient on the computation side. But generally speaking, here's the kind of general overview of the architecture. You have an encoder and a decoder. So inside the encoder and the decoder, you can have different types of blocks. So it can be RNN, can be CNN. And the idea is that you join the embeddings. So the encoder will get the input word vectors to represent the sentence context. And then the decoder takes it and computes the rest with some sliding window to account for the sequential nature. But yeah, it's not great for long word dependency. So if you have 50 words, you need to make 50 steps in order to compute. Okay, so now building on that, a big team from Google released something called the Transformer, which is released, which is based on something called the attention. So the paper is pretty short and quite understandable, even if it's just a tip of that uses a lot of initial work done elsewhere. Attention is all you need because so here's if you're interested, this is the let's say general overview of the architecture. So a bit less than a year ago. What is attention? That's a type of block that, in some ways, can reproduce the way we choose to focus on some things or not. A visualization is probably better to explain it. But for instance, here you have the attention weight matrix of the French and the English. Just how many of you speak French? Just so I know, so I don't make too many French jokes. Okay, yeah. So we do plan to have a Dutch version. Should be released soon, if I get GPU money. But yeah, so the idea here, if you look actually at this, which is in English, you see the linkage. Well, first of all, what elements are important, and the linkages between those. The idea is that you put in high res what is important and in low res what is not. So it reduces the dimension of a problem in a good way. Interestingly, when you apply it, I would say naively, it does not account for sequence positioning. So it's a kind of bag of word for those of you who've done a traditional NLP approach. But actually, they found a really cool way. So even by relaxing the sequence positioning, and you'll see that's very important, by adding elements, so positional encoding, they're still able to take that into account. Which is, I think, one of the key elements that that make it work. So, if you're interested, I put a few details on the exact type of block that is used for the attention. They actually use multiple of these because they have attention on the encoder, on the decoder, and after. Pretty smart. They, I think it's a good technique for compressed sensing that applies well to this type of problem. An overview so of a general architecture. You have the input, so language A that comes in. You have this attention. So don't worry about the multi-head. I'll explain it a bit. It's actually more straightforward than it sounds. You put it to a feed-forward layer to project it, and then, so you have a attention layer on the output as well, and then all of that is fed again to an attention. So, pretty tricky. I feel like nowadays research in deep learning is really about finding the right type of architecture to a given problem. They probably tried a lot of different ways before getting to that. But they compare it quite a lot with different results from teams. What was really new in this architecture was that it uses only attention blocks. It didn't use CNN, RNN, or anything. And so, as I said, it relaxes the sequence positioning element. It can learn the representation of the relationship between words in the sentence, not taking into account the respective position. And that's quite important. Multi-head attention, so it's just that they found it was more powerful to do some linear projections. So it's a bit like if you do traditional machine learning, like ensembling. You linear project, you do multiple times the attention layer on different linear projections, constrained by the dimension. So you don't increase the complexity of the model. And that's actually more robust because ensembling, right? I'd be interested to see if there are more theoretical results on this, but the thing is, it works. So a quick example on one sentence of how it works. So you have the encoding first. So assuming you go from English to French, so you get here to the word vectors, and then you decode it. So you have one trick here. If I go back here for the output, you add a mask. You add this mask because you want to respect the autoregressive nature of the language. Sorry for autoregressive. Just mean that you should learn the next word based on the previous one and not use the futures. So the mask is simply a way to say, don't use these weights so far. They are in the future. You should not do that. So that's why here on the decoding side, it works well, playing back the animation. It took me quite a while to understand what the animation was doing. But actually, if you read the paper and you see the background of like the encoding and decoding, it's pretty pretty good. Huh, people are writing on the chat. I hope they are not playing with the translator and making silly stuff. So yeah, and so the start is because you take one step to force it to predict the next word. So yeah, I arrived at the je suis arrivé. So at the moment, my translator at least the Google demo works fine. So what about the performance? This is straight from the paper, but just was really really interesting work because. So this element, the transformer big, is a version that they made for running on 4 to 8 GPUs. And it outperformed for, so they compared for English to French and English to German. And the blue scores were higher to the state of the art in the literature. And more importantly, forgetting about the blue score, the training cost was orders of magnitude less, which is really interesting because we were getting at a point where people were fighting for incremental blue score results at the expense of like enormous networks. And we all know that's kind of overfitting, or at least not a good use of computing resources. There's actually a theoretical result on that explains why it's so much faster, which essentially because the it is fixed, which is completely different to a recurrent approach, where for a recurrent or even a convolutional, well, the complexity and the maximum path length, so the maximum path length is the number of steps required for a model to propagate long-range dependencies between layers. So let's say that if a word is 50 words apart from the other, you have to make these 50 steps in the graph, seen as a network. So the complexity, the path length increases way more. For self-attention, it's O of one, which means that it's quite fixed. It's more predictable, more efficient. And they even proposed a restricted version to control it even more. And to have a fix, so you actually know what you get, and memory wise, it's really important. So, just picturing on the previous results, so the train continued when they thanks to the transformer approach. So this was before the transformer. So completely they confirmed, and I hope this year they continue to do so. Not sure, it's probably more of a convex somewhere. But so for your information, it's from 0 to 100. So 100 would be a perfect translation. So here it's still, there's some room for improvement, but it's quite impressive when you look at the trend. Another good news, because deep learning is under a lot of fire these days, being accused of being a black box. I would say that's really unfair, because it depends on the type of architecture and on many things. In the case of the transformer architecture, what was interesting is that it enabled you to open the black box and to interpret, for instance, the relationship between the input A and the output A in the other language. So both to capture the fact that some words were linked in a given language, and that those... So that's pretty natural here, that you have a diagonal element. It's actually not quite diagonal, because as you see, it understood that here, là, is something French, so là is just the. We love to add little words like that don't mean anything, where English is way more efficient. So by itself, it understood that is all linked, which is quite interesting. It understands structure of grammars, like here, etc. So, I mean, given a bit of knowledge of how the model works, you could explain why it gave such a translation. An example which I think is even more impressive than the matrix. It's just a different. It also shows you how just the way you visualize things can make the difference. But here, taking the example of why did the animal cross the street, or did not cross the street in this instance, well, with the transformer approach, when you look at, so this is a representation of the attention weights, in a self-reference way. So remember, we had several attention layers. We had an attention layer for one language, one from one language to another. So just looking at the same language, so it's the same sentence on the two columns. Just changing one word, so in one case, it's the animal didn't cross the street because it was too tired. It is very, what does it mean? And the other is the animal didn't cross the street because it was too wide. So naturally, it understood that a street cannot get tired, but an animal can. So more hands-on, because time is flying. So a few elements which I hope would be interesting to you if you want to build such a project, or if you have. How to build such a thing. So we did it in a notebook. Well, it's mostly the work of another Alex called Alex Wolf in the US, which I helped a bit on it. So that's something that we can provide. So there was already great notebooks made by the Tensor to Tensor team, and we a bit adapted it to make it simpler to handle for our new users. What's really nice, so we use Tensor to Tensor, which is an abstraction on top of TensorFlow. But it works well for translation, but also any other kind of tensor to tensor. So any a sequence to another sequence, which can mean that you can use it for generating images, generating other kind of text, not in a translation context, or a time series, etc. And they have like a really great documentation. I have thanks. If I think some people are from Google here, but anyway, like I think it's a big kudos to the community of researchers who made it open source and well documented, which is even more important than open source. And it has pre-built code for a lot of things, so it's really an amazing toolbox to play with. Yeah, so I'm gonna try to make a few demos to highlight a few elements, and then we'll try this this live demo. Yep. Yeah. So this is our shared GPU instance, and so we. By the way, so we are all working on the same instance. Thanks to DSS, which is actually both neat and painful because it means that 20 data scientists are competing for the same GPU resources. So so we actually made a bot for that. So I'll just check that very quickly that I have some. Ah, see, okay, Hisham and Arthur are using the GPU again. But anyway, I'll just show you the code, and I won't run their GPUs. Otherwise, they scream like, "Wow, what did you do? I was working on this important project for generating fake images, or I don't know what." So, mostly code. We prototyped it here, and so that's we have a cleaner version of this in that we can share on GitHub. So yeah, it has to do. So yeah, I should probably put Dutch definitely before in the list. Macedonian, really. So yeah, really simple. If you want to make train a translator in a given language, you can just say instead of EN to FR, you can say EN to NL. And rev is for reversing, so French to English, etc. Very, very simply, in the param, say what kind of tensor to tensor model you want to apply. So here, I'm using the transformer, the last thing from Google. So I hope if they continue to maintain it and if they make a cool new architecture, it would be as easy as just changing this parameter to use it. And I only have one GPU, so I didn't get as good results as Google Translate, so I'm blaming it on the number of GPUs. Because they in there, to be fair, it could be a good explanation because they used 8 for their paper, and we run for the same duration. So probably we didn't have the convergence was slower. They even have a way to generate the training data. So because that's actually could be more challenging than building the architecture itself. They bundled with it a downloader system to get the training data from WMT, which is a kind of golden standard, like MNIST for the digit recognition stuff. It's this kind of benchmark data set, but for translation. Obviously, you could get better results through proprietary data scraping or things like that. So, for instance, there's guys at Lingui. They made a company called DeepL. Since they had so much translation data, and they want to compete with Google Translate on this side, and it's actually quite impressive as well. I don't know if they use the same kind of architecture, but definitely having a lot of labeled data is a way to improve. But yeah, just going back here, it's actually, I hope, quite simple. If you have any question on the example, you can come ask me. I can very easily now say which GPU I want to use, etc. And then automatically, this will launch my model. And I have a TensorBoard that is attached. So let me see if the TensorBoard is... Yeah, it's up. So TensorBoard, if you've never used it, is a really nifty tool that TensorFlow is bundling with. So you just point TensorFlow, TensorBoard to the training directory, and it reads the configuration files and gives you not only, so these things are more for checking the training, but you can also evaluate your model. And even, so it's an approximation, it's not the true blue score, but they can, across the training, monitor the blue score that is read at each checkpoint. So here, just a small warning, the approximate blue score is a slightly modified version than the real theoretical blue score. The theoretical blue score would be a bit lower, but this is just a computational compromise. So after 1 day and 17 hours, we reach 44, which is not too bad. But anyway, let's have a... I run the experiment. I updated the English to French translation today. So I was a bit nervous that it would not work. In theory, I was okay, because I knew that the blue score was higher than the previous version. So what happened, to give a bit of background before I do the demo, is so we bundled the code for that in an API framework we have, which is a way to package APIs a bit faster. So based on the training directory, we bundle it here. And we just say here, read the data folder with French to English, initialize the weights, and then encode, decode to get me the correct sequence. And we deployed it to an external API and then integrated it to our chat. We are using HipChat. It's an Atlassian chat platform, a bit similar to Slack. And yeah, it was actually pretty easy to update. I was pleasantly surprised. So some of you have watched it, there was a cool presentation by the French government around AI. So I tried this, and after I'll try something that I found on the web. Yeah, because I know this one is working. So you see, it's probably improvements for later on, is that it takes a bit of time because the computation is the training was on GPU, but the computation for scoring is on a CPU, and initializing the network is a bit long, but probably just a configuration. So it's actually, I'm the only one who can judge, but it's actually a really, really good prediction of this. So if I looked at another section of, or actually even if I try to translate, Amsterdam. Okay, so it's not too bad. It's actually interesting. What I found cool is that it's a bit behaving like a human. So if it doesn't know, it just uses the same word. So somehow content means happy, and it's just using content. Ah, okay. Okay, so you understand it. Okay, that's a good news. But the rest of it, it got pretty well. So we are improving this. We did not plan. We do not plan as of today to offer any kind of translation service. But based on the code, you could try and improve it and deploy it in your context. Okay. So a few resources. Yeah. Just to conclude, on a few elements. What could be the next step for for our own experiment, but generally speaking, areas of research that are interesting today are using this type of architecture to be able to train multiple languages at the same time. Because as of today, it's like one network for English to French and one from French to English, and a completely different one from Japanese to Korean, etc. And probably at some point, it's quite exciting, we can do something that a kind of Babel, which understands every language, it can seamlessly translate one into the other based on a shared representation of meaning. Beyond translation, one thing that is interesting is the same attention layer can be used, for instance, for parsing. So finding the grammatical relationship between words, for semantic parsing, etc. So generally speaking, attention can be applied to many things in related to our own language. So I hope you find it interesting, enlightening, and don't hesitate if you have any question now or around a beer later on. Okay. Yeah, one.
Mm-hmm. If my labeled data are just bigrams, for instance,
yeah,
versus having full sentences translated by humans, or even having four paragraphs, I would expect a different behavior.
Yeah.
So is there any, either from your experience on it, or any paper study that shows the how the effectiveness
So for actual papers, I don't know, but I would expect the performance to go down. Yeah, yeah.
When
you look at longer texts, is that was your question? Yeah.
The issue is that there's no context.
Yeah.
So I was wondering if we give to the network, the neural network, training data that really lack context, will it affect the effectiveness?
Yeah, for sure. I would say, even if it's less so than the traditional statistical approaches, it's still quite sensitive to the training data that you give it. So it's like from my experiments talking to the bot when I'm lonely, it performs well for traditional things like a business journal or things like that. If you want to make jokes or slang, it really doesn't work. So it learned to translate well for a type of language. Sorry?
So I'm wondering how attention deal with synonyms. So the words have similar meaning. And how?
So attention weights are more about the relationship in a syntactic sense, the fact that the words are synonym would be captured at another type of layer, which is the word vector that arrives actually before the attention layer. So when it's actually a complex architecture, so there's different things in the human language that are captured at different layers of a network.